All right, we'll have a look at grinding and abrasive machining. So, a lot of people's exposure to grinding sometimes is, you know, maybe a pedestal grinder or some sandpaper and things like that. But these days, grinding and abrasive machining is pretty advanced science, and there's some pretty interesting equipment out there. It's kind of worth looking around. All right, so abrasive machining really is one of the oldest machining process. And so machining is this removal of material, this chip making class of processes. So, you know, there was forging and things like that before abrasive machining. But say you had beaten a piece of metal into shape, the way that you got a nice sharp edge on it was to grind it against something, a piece of sandstone or something like that, to actually grind it. And that was chip making. And even, you know, to make the first chisel, to go in and make the first file, required a piece of piece of metal, and you would sharpen that on some abrasive material. So pretty much the oldest machining process out there. We talked about machining being using these wedge-shaped tools to remove metal. And when you look at a grinding wheel, it may not look like a wedge-shaped tool, but when you zoom in and look at the actual individual abrasive grains, they are wedge-shaped. And so this fits nicely into that same classification. So in abrasive machining, the abrasive can be a free abrasive, that is, it's not mounted to anything. It's just like sand used in things like sandblasting and various other processes that have the abrasive not mounted in any way, but free. The abrasive can also be mounted, that is, in a to a belt or a piece of paper, or bonded together into wheels or stones. And sometimes those stones are mounted onto a shaft, in which case we call them mounted abrasives or mounted wheels. So abrasives have these characteristics, some of these more desirable than others. For instance, hardness. So hardness, we talked about in metals, we mostly talk about that being resistance to indentation. In abrasives, it makes a little more sense to talk about them as resistance to scratching. Friability is the characteristic of a abrasive wheel for the grit to shear away and to break away and expose new sharp edges. Friability sounds like it might be something undesirable, but if the wheel doesn't wear down, if those abrasive grains don't get sheared off and make way for new abrasive grains, then they get filled up with metal and they clog up and they won't cut as well. Then there is attritious wear. So this is where the grains wear out. So maybe you have a wheel that's not hard enough for the material that you're trying to cut, and so the wheel will dull, it will glaze, it will get a coating of the material you're trying to machine away on it. Kind of a dangerous condition, and that's what you don't want. So some common abrasive materials, by an overwhelming margin, the most commonly used abrasive material out there is aluminum oxide. So this exists naturally in a lot of different forms, but it's made commercially, synthetically today, and is hugely, hugely popular. Very nice general purpose abrasive, and it can be put, there are different sort of varieties of aluminum oxide for different conditions. Silicon carbide, also a fairly common abrasive, but not nearly as common as aluminum oxide. At one time it was quite popular, and we'll talk about some of these, we'll break some of these out. Zirconia alumina or zirconium, the ceramic materials, CBN, cubic boron nitride, is a very, very hard material. CBN is really the hardest material that you can use to grind ferrous metals and other, there's some other related metals, but think mostly about ferrous metals being incompatible with diamond. So diamond is the hardest abrasive overall, and it's good for certain non-ferrous metals, but CBN, if you try to use a diamond with ferrous metals, you see, you already know that carbon can dissolve really easily into steel, into ferrous metals, steel and cast iron. And so a diamond wheel will chemically dissolve away as you're grinding it to grind ferrous metals, but really good for other many non-ferrous metals. But CBN sort of fills that gap. It's a high-performance artificial abrasive that can be used quite handily on steel and other ferrous metals. All right, like we said, aluminum oxide, very, very popular abrasive material, widely used, kind of a nice general-purpose abrasive. Silicon carbide, like we said, it's, well, I don't know how much we said about this, I forgot, but it is the oldest artificial abrasive, one of the first synthetically made artificial abrasives, and it's very hard. It is friable, it's brittle. It can cut really fast, but it has a short life. You see it sometimes in cutoff wheels. A lot of times silicon carbide will be sort of a black color or a green color. Sometimes it's used with titanium because of its doesn't contaminate the material, and it has limited use. You'll also see silicon carbide used in things like grip tape and wet or dry sandpaper, things like that. Sometimes used to grind tungsten carbide. Now we talked a little bit about CBN, cubic boron nitride. The main thing to remember about CBN is it's the hardest abrasive that's compatible with ferrous metals. It's not going to dissolve away the way that the diamond will. You'll also see it like it is in this image as a cutting tool material. So CBN inserts in a cutting tool material for high performance, high speed machining. So the diamonds that are used as abrasives, these are obviously not sort of gemstone quality. They are off-color stones. They can also be made synthetically. And you'll also use diamonds to dress and to true and dress other abrasive wheels. So this is a diamond dressing tool mounted here, truing and dressing that wheel there. All right, so as these abrasives work, first of all, a little bit about the geometry. Remember we said that these are wedge-shaped tools. So the rake angle and the clearance angle, all of the rules that apply to cutting tool geometry still really apply to abrasive geometry, but they're so random that they can't really be predicted. They're just completely randomized. So sometimes you get a real careful shearing action. Sometimes you get this cutting action. Sometimes the material doesn't quite get sheared off. It just gets pushed to the side, and that's called plowing. So the abrasive grain plows through the geometry or through the workpiece and moves material to the side, but it doesn't quite shear it off the way that it would in cutting action. And you can also, when the rake angle gets really, really low, you can have this rubbing action or this wiping action of the abrasive grain. So you get a combination of all of these, thousands and thousands of times a second, and that's sort of what the process looks like. But it will shear off eventually, making these little chips that are not too unlike chips made in a other machining process. All right, we'll talk a little bit about selecting a grinding wheel. And when you go to shop for grinding wheels, kind of like with cutting tool inserts, you know that there is a code that sort of describes the geometry of that wheel. And what we're going to do is kind of step through that code and have a look. But first of all, the shape of the wheel. So there are two main types of wheels. There are peripheral grinding wheels and there are face grinding wheels. Okay, so let me drop back to the peripheral grinding wheels. These are designed to be used out here on the periphery. You can see that these are labeled that this is the grinding face. So this is a cylindrical wheel, a type 1 straight wheel. And So this, out here on this surface, on the periphery, that is the spot where you're to be, you know, where this wheel's designed to be used, where it's designed to make contact with the work. If you've ever seen somebody walk up to a pedestal grinder or a bench grinder and start grinding tools on the side, that's somebody you should keep your eye on, because that is not the way to use these wheels. That is a dangerous thing to do, to grind a peripheral grinding wheel on this face, because what that does is these wheels spin at really high speed, and there's tremendous centrifugal force trying to break that wheel apart. And when you grind on the face of those wheels, you're weakening that wheel, and it is an invitation to disaster. Now, these are face grinding wheels. These wheels are designed to be cut on the face. So this cup wheel, for instance, you mount this thing. These are used a lot of times for grinding tools, cutting tools. And so the face that you're to use, that it's designed to be used with, is here. All right, so on the circular part of the wheel. All right, so there is a standard out there for how you mark and identify grinding wheels. It's ANSI B74.13, and this is just kind of a look at that code. We'll kind of step through this. So first of all, the manufacturer can put a prefix on the beginning of this, and they can put a code at the end of this to sort of differentiate between product that may have an identical ANSI code. So identify sort of what the special sauce is in that particular wheel. All right, so first of all, let me just drop back here. The abrasive type, in this case, this has an A. All right, so A tells us it's aluminum oxide. There are also different types of aluminum oxide, so you may have something in front of this sort of identifying which sort of type of aluminum oxide you're dealing with. Z for zirconia, C for silicon carbide. Then the abrasive grain size. So this is going to be a number, and what it is the abrasive grains are sorted by a sieve, the series of sieves that they can fit through, and the size of the sieve is given with a number. So that's the number of openings per inch. All right. So if you have the larger the number, then the more openings per inch you have, and that means that it's smaller and smaller abrasive grains that can fit through that sieve. So for the purpose of grinding wheels, coarse, is these look like really kind of big numbers if you were talking about sandpaper or any kind of polishing compounds. But for grinding wheels, this is kind of how they break down. But so a number 4, that's like 4 openings per inch. That means those grains could be almost a quarter of an inch or so. All right, so if you haven't found the grinding doc online on YouTube, the very, very good series, very underrated. I don't know why they don't have more views, but they are, if you're working for a company and you have anything to do with grinding, that's where you should be, not in this PowerPoint, but over listening to the grinding doc from Cutting Tool Engineering Magazine. Very great series there. But anyway, so that's, I'm just going to plug that. All right, so the smaller grain sizes are good for grinding harder materials. They're going to take less stock away, better for flat, uninterrupted surface cuts. They'll give you better finish, and there's a smaller contact area between the wheel and the work. So larger grain sizes, you would go in the reverse of this, so softer materials for heavy stock removal, being able to handle interrupted cuts. So that's like, interrupted cut is when you had a channel or groove cut into a surface. So where the wheel's making contact as it moves across, and then it stops making contact in that groove, and then it recontacts again. So there's an interruption in the cutting action. I think we talked about that when we talked about machining and turning. So it's when you're cutting, then you're not cutting, then you're cutting again. All right. All right, so there is a grade for the wheels, and that is given by a letter in that code. A softer wheel will be down here toward the beginning of the alphabet, and a harder wheel toward the end of the alphabet. So softer wheels, better for fast cutting. They're less prone to chatter, the lower noise. They don't provide as nice a surface finish, and they're also less good at holding their shape. So that's what they're talking about when they're saying form holding. So if you're grinding a particular shape, even if it's flat, a softer wheel is going to lose that shape faster and have to be retrued and dressed faster. And of course, sort of the opposite stuff for a harder wheel. All right, then there is the structure of the wheel. So this is how densely packed in together the individual abrasive grains are. So a dense wheel will have a low number, and an open wheel will have a higher number. So a denser wheel, better for holding its form. This is what's used for things like tooling, cutter sharpening, where you have to do some really nice precision work, just grinding in things like clearance geometry, reliefs, sharpening. Let's see, moderately open for surface and cylindrical grinding. We'll talk a little bit about what surface and cylindrical grinding are, and actually we need to talk about blanchard grinding later on. But you can see a very open surface or very open wheel structure for heat-sensitive parts. Now then there's the bond type. So the bond is kind of the glue that's holding the wheel together. There is a type of bond that's called a vitrified bond, which is essentially a glass-based or porcelain sort of ceramic material bonding the wheel together. You can also have a resin or sort of a plastic bond, a rubber bonded wheel. There's also things called a shellac bonded wheel. This is a natural adhesive, and epoxy bonded wheels. And then, like we said, at the end, the manufacturer has some space at the end of that code to put in whatever particular information relates to their to that specific wheel. All right. So those are traditional wheels. There are also, there's a separate code for the very, very hard abrasive CBN and diamond wheels, kind of are their own little world, and they have a very similar system, but I'm not gonna go into it because I don't want to, for the test, I don't want you to be overly inundated with information. So what I'm gonna do for testing purposes, just so you're aware, is I'll give you a couple of different codes on the test, and I may say which one has a finer abrasive and which one has a more open structure, which one is a vitrified bond, things like that, and you choose from maybe from the multiple choice the wheel code that matches whatever the description is. And so I'm not going to give you descriptions from CBN and diamond wheels. All right, so we'll look at some of the abrasive machining processes. These videos are in the lecture notes. I'll link to those, but some really nice profile grinding here. So here they've got an involute ground on this grinding wheel, and they are transferring that form from this grinding wheel onto this pretty large gear on there. So this is profile grinding, where you're grinding an actual shape onto a workpiece. Surface grinding, mostly about just grinding a flat surface. So this is our tool design class. That's the little engraving cutter that we make in that class when the world is not suffering from a pandemic. So that's a little engraving cutter, and we're grinding the rake face on that cutter. But generally, surface grinding is used to just make a large flat surface, like on the top of this part. This piece was surface ground on that surface, but a wide open area where it's flat, just back and forth, and creating a nice planar shape. Blanchard grinding is sort of a variant of surface grinding. It is a rotary surface grinding operation. There we go. So this, there you see the workpiece, the pieces rotating under the workpiece, and then the Blanchard grinder, which is composed of segments rotating again parallel to that plane. So Blanchard grinding makes kind of a characteristic swirl pattern on the workpiece. Cylindrical grinding, as you might expect, is grinding around a cylindrical shape, grinding on a cylinder. This can be OD grinding, or outside diameter grinding, or it can be ID grinding, or inside diameter grinding. There is a type of grinding called centerless grinding, which creates a nice round part without any kind of respect to a central surface. So if you need roundness, and you don't really need the roundness to be attached to any to an axis, centerless grinding is good for that. So if what you're after is strictly roundness, the way this works is here's your workpiece in the middle, and there's a regulating wheel that rotates and causes the workpiece to rotate into the grinding wheel, which goes through and follows the outside periphery of the part. So there are two main categories of centerless grinding. There's plunge centerless grinding, where this, obviously, you see they have different shoulder heights on here. They have different diameters along this workpiece. So you drop the piece into a plunge-type centerless grinding. And then there's through-feed centerless grinding, where the parts can flow completely through. Another process, this is a free abrasive process, is abrasive flow machining. So this is done where you need to get access to sort of cooling channels or inside inside passages where you can't reach with an ordinary grinding wheel or honing brushes or anything like that. You can pump this abrasive slurry through the material. So this is... Extrude Hone is a company that does that makes equipment that does this process. So it's kind of this thick, heavy, abrasive slurry that gets pumped through there, and that allows you to come in here and deburr these interior intersections, things like that. Another process that I'm just going to mention briefly, this is really a processes two kind of thing, but I thought I'd mention it because it's a free abrasive process. And it's pretty popular these days, and that is abrasive water jet cutting, where you pressurize water to a very high pressure and feed in little tiny particles of abrasive material, and that allows you to cut pretty much anything. All right, glass, ceramic, concrete, metals, whatever it is, doesn't have to conduct electricity, doesn't have to, it can be extremely hard. Things like that. So abrasive water jet cutting, something to be familiar with. All right, another free abrasive process is sandblasting. You're probably already familiar with this. There are a lot of, a better term is probably media blasting, because a lot of times the media is not sand, but it can be. There are lots of different media that can be used for different purposes to try to remove something off of the surface and yet not damage the substrate that's underneath. You'll notice these people are wearing a lot of protective equipment, and that is to reduce their silica exposure. Something about, that's a pretty important thing these days is reducing your exposure to silica dust, like you would find in concrete and sandblasting and things like that. It's kind of the new upcoming asbestos, so it's a pretty good video there on silica exposure. All right, tool grinding, kind of a specialized area of grinding for sharpening and shaping cutting tools. There's some pretty advanced tool grinding stuff out there. Let's see, then there's snagging or manual grinding. This is a pretty large pedestal grinder that they're doing snagging. Snagging is typically, it's one of the fettling operations. So fettling is cleaning up a casting. So a lot of times you'll hear, in foundries and things like that, this is a fettling process or snagging process. And that is a really rough manual grinding process. All right, another process is creep feed grinding. So in general, the depth of cut in a grinding operation is really, really small, and the feed rate is pretty fast. And what creep feed grinding does is increases that depth of cut and slows the feed rate down. All right, so this is, you're seeing this a little bit more in the past few years where you can use creep feed grinding. Seems to kind of be growing in popularity, but it's kind of slowly. It's able to hold tight tolerances. You can cut really hard material. And what creep feed grinding is basically doing is kind of replacing some of the machining steps. And so I'm thinking maybe one of the reasons that you see more of this is a movement towards lean, where maybe it takes a little bit longer to machine something, but it eliminates an entire machining operation. So instead of going from a milling machine and then going to a grinder, you can chuck up just in the grinder, take a little bit longer to remove the material, but save an entire machining step and maybe cut down on some WIP or work in process and things like that. Just like machining, there is up grinding and down grinding. And in general, when you're creep feed grinding, the down grinding is, that would be climb grinding if we're comparing it to climb milling. But it does require, you know, a machine that is designed to do this. Now, you may have heard of honing before. You may have seen an engine block that's bored and honed, or you may have had to have a brake cylinder honed or something like that. But honing is a process that's only designed to remove a little bit of material. It uses a mounted abrasive, and it takes really light strokes and only kind of cleans up and sort of puts a pattern and brings the diameter up to size kind of slowly. So you'll notice in this operation, they have a really fast feed rate back and forth, and what that does, that's going to produce a sort of a crosshatched pattern on the inside of that cylinder, and that's by design. That is to help the oil to coat and flow around the piston and coat the inside of the cylinder properly. This is a flexible brush hone, just an example, another example of some of this grinding technology. Now, lapping is a process that's designed to take off even less material, very, very small metal removal, usually less than a thou. Okay, so this is used sometimes to bring in very precise work just to the very last stages of its fit. So to try to get the material, get whatever it is, if it's a cylinder or whatever the shape is, to bring it into its very final shape and very final size. So in lapping, you have an abrasive material. The material is a lapping compound, and that's what you see here in these bottles. You can get diamond lapping compound in very, 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 very fine grits, and you'll charge a soft material called a lap with that free abrasive, and just slide your workpiece across the lap. Now, the lap, the abrasive materials will get embedded into that lap. So if you are using a particular grip with a particular lap, that's the only grit size that you want to use with that lap. You don't want to try to use it with finer grit, because it will already be charged with a more coarse grit. And you don't, once you've used a lap with a particular grit, you need to kind of stick with that grit for that lap. Then there's a process called super finishing, kind of like lapping. Only the material, the abrasive, is mounted. It's kind of a little bit like honing, I guess. I guess it's more like honing, but it's only taking off just the very tiniest amount of material. It's only going to be taking off really the little tiny high spots. You know, there may be thousands of them, but it's going to be taking off those high spots. And as those high spots go away, the material, the media, that is the belt or the stones that are doing the machining, will begin to get separated from the workpiece by this hydrodynamic wedging. That is a fluid that's used in the super finishing process, will begin to separate the material, the abrasive media from the workpiece. So that's a pretty good little video there about some super finishing. That's using tape, obviously, and you can see the compound in there, the fluid that's going to do the job of kind of separating. All right, so this uses really, really fine abrasives, really light pressure, and short strokes. And what this is designed so that the workpiece and the abrasive media never coincide the same way twice. So the grains will never take the same path, and it just removes very, very tiny amounts of material. I believe this process was started by Chrysler. I believe they developed that. All right, and then about buffing and polishing. So this is just the taking off very, very tiny, tiny amounts of materials, and also taking and kind of wearing flat down the high spots and making them uniform. This has to happen just, in fact, all of these, I should say many of these abrasive processes take place in stages, but especially when you're buffing and polishing, you're going to start with a grit that's close to the roughness of the surface that you're trying to polish. Okay, so you start with really, you know, fine sandpaper that's maybe has about the same roughness as the height of the surface that you're trying to improve. And then you go in sequence and drop that down a little bit at a time. What you can't do is come in here and try to short circuit this process where you say, well, yeah, I'll clean it up with a coarse grit or a medium grit, and then I'll go straight to polishing, because what you'll wind up doing is only polishing the high spots, and you'll be left with all of these valleys, which will appear as scratches in your workpiece. And so to get a polished surface, polishing a surface is really not hard at all. You just polish it. But if you want a polished surface that doesn't have scratches in it, then you have to go through this sequence. And same sort of idea with woodworking. You start with, medium sandpaper, and you move to finer and finer grits. Same idea applies here. All right, so as you use these grinding wheels, like we said at the beginning, they're designed to wear down. So the grinding wheels, if they're working properly, are wearing down. So periodically, you have to improve the wheel geometry. And there's two steps to this, truing and dressing. So truing is actually making the wheel the right shape, and dressing is cleaning it out and opening up the cutting surfaces inside the wheel. So if you have a traditional, something like an aluminum oxide wheel, you can take a diamond dressing tool and you can drag it across the surface. I'm thinking like in a surface grinder or something. You feed that diamond dressing tool across the face of the wheel. And on a traditional wheel like that, truing and dressing happen at the same time. So you drag that diamond across the surface, you square the wheel up, make it nice and straight and cylindrical. And that changes the shape, and it also opens up pores and gets rid of any metal that might be embedded in the surface. On a diamond or CBN wheel, these things, they're separate processes. So you true the wheel, but truing the wheel on a diamond wheel involves grinding that thing flat, and you wind up closing up the openings, the grinding openings, and you wind up with a very dull wheel. And so you condition that wheel or dress that wheel with a conditioning stick that will clean out the wheel and allow it to cut. So here's truing and dressing an aluminum wheel, and you can dress different geometry on these wheels. So this is a little CNC dresser, and they're putting a different shape on there. Sometimes you'll use a carborundum stick or a silicon carbide stick to rough the wheel into shape, and then separately use the diamond to cut whatever shape you want to on there. This can be done manually or with CNC equipment. So like I said, on an aluminum oxide wheel, that process is truing, but it's also dressing the wheel. And this is dressing a CBN or diamond wheel with a wheel conditioning stick. All right, this video is not about grinding at all, but this is the slow-mo guys, and the reason I put this in here is because this is when you take a when a grinding wheel fails, it fails in a manner very, very similar to this, so it will just completely come apart. All right, they're dangerous. Okay, so grinding wheels can just fail explosively, and giant chunks of grinding wheel can go for a very, very far, very far distance. So you need to always take care of wheels. They need to be handled very carefully. People in the plant that are going to be handling the wheels need to know that they have to take care of those wheels, and they have to be handled like eggs. All right, so there is, for vitrified wheels, you know, there's the idea that you can test them by sound, and that's kind of a last-minute double-check sort of thing. I'm not sure how much I trust it, but giving them a little tap with a wooden file handle, for instance, they should ring nicely. If they have sort of a dull thunk sound to them, then they've been damaged. I don't know how reliable that is, but if you give it a little tap and you hear a dull thump, then I would not use that wheel. But the wheels shouldn't be rolled, they shouldn't be dropped or bumped, and they need to be stacked very carefully, and you don't want to store things on top of the wheels. You know, really at the top of this lecture, the thing to know is that a lot of these grinding operations are not safe. Okay, so just like any shop, any process in the machine shop, you know, you need to be safe, you need to be careful, but especially with grinding, there's just an awful lot that can go wrong with a grinding operation. All right, so that's basically it. If you have any questions, let me know, and we'll see you later.